Last week, we began looking at 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7 through 11, as we continued our series, Living in Right Relationships. And as I told you last week, I initially grabbed hold of those verses and planned to do a four-part sermon. And as I started working through the first part, I realized part one was one of the longest manuscripts I ever wrote in my life. And I realized that if I was going to do four parts in one sermon, we were going to be here a long time. And so after the wise counsel of some very large men who told me they weren't going to stay that long, I decided we better do something different. And so we are getting into the second part of our sermon on living in right relationships within the church. As we talked about last week, there are two classes of people that the Bible talks about. There are those who have trusted in the person and work of Christ for the forgiveness of their sins, and who are the church, and there are those who have not. And all peoples, at all times, in all places, fall into one of those two categories. And so as Peter is writing to the church in Turkey, he begins by making sure first that they live in right relationship with Christ, but then secondly that they live in right relationship with each other. And last week we realized that living in right relationship begins with getting serious and disciplined about prayer. And for those of you who missed that sermon will be online tonight and be promoted tomorrow, so you can catch up from last week. But after we get serious about prayer, Peter leads us on into verses 8 and 9 and invites us to love liberally. If we're going to live in right relationship with each other, we must commit to love liberally. And so if you will, I invite you to stand with me as we look once again at 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7 through 11, and discover from God's Word today about the beauty of loving liberally as we maintain a right relationship within the church. And the Word of the Lord says this: "Now the end of all things is near. Therefore, be serious and disciplined for prayer. Above all, maintain an intense love for each other, since love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaining. Based on the gift each one has received, use it to serve others as good managers of the varied grace of God. If anyone speaks, it should be as one who speaks God's words. If anyone serves, it should be from the strength God provides, so that God may be glorified through Jesus Christ in everything. To Him belong the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen." Let's pray. Our Father, as we look to Your Word today, I pray that You would speak to our hearts, that a liberal love would flow from each and every one of our lives into the lives of those around us, that You would establish right relationship among Your people as we strive to be faithful to Your call. That, Father, as You give us the grace to love, let us love. And let that liberal love flow into every corner of our lives together, that You would be glorified in us and through us. And it's in Your precious and holy name we pray. Amen. And you may be seated. A man was in the doghouse with his wife. Some of you men can relate. And so he went to the florist and sent her some flowers. The card was to read, "I'm sorry, I love you." But the man's instructions apparently were not very clear. And when the wife received her flowers, the card said, "I'm sorry, I love you." Just a simple miscommunication illustrates how easy relationships can go awry. You know, we know that. And this little moment of levity provides us an opportunity to see just how easy things can just go goofy. Can't they? You know, you get up, you're having a great day, and suddenly you say something with just the wrong tone to your spouse, and all of a sudden, you're in a fight. Now, I'm not talking about one of those little arguments at work that you walk away from. I'm talking about a straight-on, full-on, bare-knuckle brawl with the love of your life. Where 5 minutes ago, things were happy. Things were filled with joy and happiness. And all of a sudden now, y'all don't even want to look at one another. We done got mad. I know y'all have never experienced that. Some of y'all are looking at me going, was he in the car with us this morning? No, it's easy for relationships to go sideways. And yet, as we look at verses 8 and 9 today, we find an instruction to help us live in right relationship within the church. Now look, we use the example of our spouses, and most of us have believing spouses, so it equally applies, but isn't it easy for relationships to go sideways at church too? You know, just the wrong thing at the wrong time, and suddenly we don't like anybody that's ever been to our church ever. We hate them all. I'm never going back. Why? They made me mad. What did they do? Well, they just made me mad. Well, they did this, or they treated me like this, or I worked really hard and nobody appreciated what I did on this one time. Well, do they ever tell you thank you for what you do? Oh yeah, all the time, but they didn't this one time, and so I'm not going back. Guys, relationships can go sideways in a hurry. Relationships can go sideways without us even intending on going that way. But it does happen. And so Peter gives us some instruction to really safeguard against that. And this, he says, is above all. Above all, yeah, let's get serious about prayer. Let's commit on this. That kind of lays some foundation. And as we talked about last week, if we get serious and disciplined about prayer, it's a lot harder for relationship damaging events to take place in our hearts and in our lives. But now we got to put some things into action among ourselves. We got to start saying, okay, now how do we deal with each other directly? And he says, love with intensity. Have an intense love for one another. Maintain an intense love. In the midst of all the differences of opinion and culture that had filled the church in Turkey, Peter knew that an intense love for each other would enable the church to overcome whatever obstacles they may face relationally. This love is not simply an emotional response. We don't get it. We hardly ever get it. As Americans, we look at love and we see it emotionally. And this is one reason why we have so many problems in our relationship, because we look at love as a feeling, and when the feeling is gone, then the love has left. Hogwash. Love is not simply a feeling. It's not simply an emotion. It's not even a passionate expression. It's a resolve to put others' best interest before our own interest. And it is illustrated by how we treat other people. We were watching a show last night, and two of the characters were fixing to get married, and one of the guys said, I love your mother, and the daughter says, that's just a word. And he says, let me show you. Love is illustrated by what we do, and it is truly fulfilled when others' best interests come first. This love seeks to express itself through what would be done within the church for each other and would meet others within the church where they are in order to build, strengthen, and preserve their relationships. I want you to think about this for just a second. Imagine a church that did not exist for the purpose of maintaining structures and systems and functions. A church that did not exist to maintain traditions or to be on the cutting edge of things or to hold fast to the way we've always done it. A church that did not prioritize stuff, but rather prioritized relationship with one another above everything else. Making sure that relationships were right and godly among their membership. And we'll deal with relationships outside. We're just dealing with what's inside right now. But dealt with relationships inside and made sure they were right above everything else they did. Think about that for just a minute. Now look, people will tell you, I'm a systems guy. I think that when you have good systems, where people know how to get answers to their questions, where people understand how things are supposed to flow, that it sets a stable environment to do ministry. But guys, I got to tell you, if the purpose of what we do is to maintain systems, we have a problem. If the maintaining of systems supersedes the maintaining of right relationships, we have a problem. And so, Peter recognizes this. Look, the church in Turkey has blown up. Hundreds, if not thousands, of believers from the Roman persecution have filled their churches, bringing different ideas and different cultures and different ways to do things. They watched their Sunday school department that had been pretty adept at building people up. They watched their Sunday school department quadruple overnight. And there's short teachers and there's short space and they're running into all of these problems. And this guy doesn't do things the way we do things. And that guy's got some crazy ideas and they did things in their church that are totally different than we do in our church. And it could destroy them. And Peter says, maintain an intense love for one another. Put that love at the top of your list. Don't let all this other stuff become the driving factor of how you deal with one another. Love one another above everything else intensely. And as a consequence of that, you will put the best interest of the other person ahead of your interest every time. When we understand that a liberal love is essential to a right relationship, then the way we interact with others will be different. How, preacher? I'm glad you asked. Look at what he says in verse 9. He says, deal with each other with hospitality. Some of you guys' Bibles may say, generously. Be hospitable. What does that all mean? It means to give without holding back. It means to give of yourself without holding back for the other's best interest. You know what's hard about being hospitable? It means you're not the most important person. That's what's really hard about it. Because most of the time we want to be catered to, right? We want people to do things for us. Some of you are looking at me going, no, I've never asked anybody to do anything for me ever. I don't believe it. I will ask your kids and they will tell me that you have made them go do stuff for you. We want to be catered to. We want people to do things for us. We want to be served. And if we're going to be hospitable, we have to act outside of our nature to serve others. To take what I want, what I desire, what my goal is, what I prioritize, and it has to go down the road, ka-chow, and move their best interest to the forefront. Generously. Not just a little bit. Not just kinda. generously, overwhelmingly giving. It's amazing. It's amazing to me. I deal with Brad all the time. You know what's amazing about Brad? Brad never says no. I have to tell Brad, Brad, you can tell me no. If I ask you to do something, you don't want to do it, don't have time to do it, aren't able to do it, you can tell me no. I'm not going to get upset. Brad's like, no, I can take care of that. I think we can make that happen. No, I think we got that under control. Brad gives generously to anything I ask him to do. Brad, we need to scrape for snow off the roof. You think you can get up on the ladder and do that? He hadn't done that yet, thankfully. We try to use people with a little bit more depth and skill than me and Brad to climb up on the roof. But if I asked him, I bet he would consider doing it. You know, he never tells me no. No matter what I ask, I don't know that I've ever heard him tell anybody no. Think we can do this? Yep, we can handle that. Yep, I'll be there. Yep, I can take care of that. He gives generously, putting other people's best interest in the forefront of what he does. That's awesome. That's a model for us to follow. I'd love to tell you that I'm that way. I'm not. I'm not that way. I have to fight everything in my nature to be hospitable because I want it my way. You know, like all of you. I want it my way. I want it my way. My way's the right way. My way's the only way. And I have to fight to be hospitable to others. We all do, but there's a cool thing. Peter tells us to do it, and I'm a big believer in what Wesley said, ought equals can. If the Bible says we ought to do something, then the Spirit makes it so we can do something. If we ought to be hospitable and love intensely, and give, putting others to the forefront generously, then the Spirit is the one that enables us to do it. Ought equals can. And so we give of our time and of our talents and of our treasures, and we give freely to those in our fellowships because of an intense love that we are committed to maintaining. No, it's not easy. If it were easy, Peter would not put the priority on focus on doing this. You know, it's hard. It's hard to love people that don't love you back, isn't it? It's hard to work with people and to serve people who don't appreciate your service. Sometimes it's hard to work with people who don't want to work with you. But we're called to maintain an intense love that is illustrated through hospitality. But it's not all about what you do. Sometimes it's about what you say. The other side of loving intensely is in verse 9, and it says, without complaining. Without complaining. We are to run away from a complaining spirit. This complaining ruins whatever generous act you may have engaged in. Whatever hospitality you may have demonstrated can absolutely be destroyed by a spirit of complaint and criticism. Love is revealed by what we do, but oftentimes it's betrayed by what we say. Jesus warns that out of the mouth flows the overflow of the heart. And I would say, what's overflowing from our hearts? Oh, I did this. I helped so-and-so. And they didn't even say thank you. I have ever heard this? I've done my time. I served in this place, but now I don't have to serve anymore. Somebody else needs to do it. But they won't do it as well as I did. You know? When we complain about the service we offer, all we do is illustrate the absence of love in our life. Funny thing about 1 Corinthians chapter 13, we call it the love chapter. And we talk about it, you know, one of the things it says is love doesn't keep score. But I'm going to tell you, some of us are excellent storekeepers. Love doesn't keep score. Love doesn't try to rack it up and go, well, I love this person to this line, but if they don't start earning some points, I'm going to stop helping. Love doesn't keep score. When we complain and we allow the spirit of criticism to season our speech, we reveal a heart that is unloving. Now you might say, well, I didn't say nothing. Okay, good for you, but if it's still the driving focus and motivation and you walk around grumpy and grumbling all the time because you serve, that doesn't help either. Just because it doesn't come out of your mouth doesn't mean a spirit of complaining and criticism doesn't exist in there. Guys, we've got to stomp that out and put that to death. It is a joy and an honor to serve and to love others. But it is the spirit of complaining and criticism that ruins what we do. So we've got to run from that. We've got to fight against that. Think about your life. How often have you betrayed your service to the kingdom and damaged your relationships within the church because of your complaining? Just think about that. Ask yourself that question. How many times have I taken what God wanted to use for good and I have just trashed it because of what I've said or what I have thought in the aftermath of the service that I provided? How often have you engaged in behind-the-scenes conversations revealing your lack of love and injuring your relationships within the church? It's funny, when I went to look up that word, what's this word complaining mean? It means behind the scenes conversation. It's the idea that I don't complain openly and loudly about what I've done. I complain to other people about the services that I've had to render. How often have we done that? How often have we damaged relationships that way? How often have we taken others to an unloving place by encouraging them to complain rather than encouraging them to give generously through love? Had a friend growing up, he was really good at it. My parents would tell me to do something and he would encourage me how to do just the minimum and complain about it the whole way. How often have you displayed a critical spirit in the midst of the service you're providing? You know, people might let you, that guy will do it for you, but he'll complain all the way. That's not a joke. And that's a terrible indictment. That's the opposite of what we're called to be. Imagine your hospitality as a pitcher of water. I was going to get a pitcher of water, but this is Slooks. That thing would be somewhere else. Trust me, I'm just not that coordinated. So imagine a pitcher of water. In and of itself, water is a life giver, isn't it? How many of you drink more than 32 ounces of water a day? Just about all of us, yeah. We drink water. I drink water all day. I drink water and coffee, and that's about all I drink. Water's a life giver. Man, water, it quenches our thirst. But the power of a critical spirit and the power of the complaining word is like adding cyanide to that pitcher of water. Doesn't really change it much, does it? Still looks the same. For most people, it still smells the same. Some people can smell the hint of almonds. But for most people, it still smells the same, looks the same, smells the same. But that life-giving water has now become a killer. If you drink enough water with cyanide in it, you will die. It looked the same. Smelled the same. Tasted the same, but it wasn't the same. What could have given life gives death in that moment. The critical and complaining spirit will kill your relationships within the church. You'll go, I feel isolated. Well, no wonder. You've murdered your relationships. You have sown seeds of discord and damage. You have hurt yourself through your complaining and through your criticisms. You have isolated yourself. yourself, and you have hurt your brothers and sisters. And it leaves you disgruntled, grumbling, and alone. And it's a terrible place to be. So we are to run from that. Run from it as hard as you can. We are to love. We are to illustrate that love through a generous hospitality, and we're to do it without complaining. Ought equals can. The Holy Spirit enables you to be different. Don't look at me and go, well, that's just the way I am. Christ saved you so you didn't have to be that guy anymore. You don't have to be that. And the Scripture says don't, which means the Spirit says you don't have to be. You can be changed. Love generously without complaining. And what happens? This is a cool thing. You know, a lot of times the Bible doesn't give us the if, then, or the cause and effect, but it does here. Go back to verse 8. It says, love with an intense love. Maintain an intense love for one another because love covers a multitude of sins. What does that mean? It's not the idea that they were going to gloss over the sins that took place within the congregation. But rather, love provided a sure foundation for the proper handling of sin within the church and a proper assessment of circumstances that took place. Why? Why would that be important? Because they just imported tons of people with different ideas and thoughts and cultures and backgrounds. Some things they were practicing in Roman churches were sin. And those things need to be dealt with. Now, how can you say that? Because Paul writes an entire New Testament dealing with sin issues within the church. Every letter in the New Testament is dealing with some kind of sin problem that has come up within the church that must be corrected. Churches are not sinless. We mentioned that last week. If you're looking for perfection, it ain't here. And it ain't anywhere else either, because sinners still sin. And in spite of all Christ has done in you, sin is a constant enemy. So there are times where we have to identify sin and we have to deal with it, and love lays the foundation for that. But a lot of things that came into the church were preference, were culture, were different ideas. Those aren't sin. Those aren't moral issues. And love lays the foundation to properly assess and address those matters. Do you think that can be important? Yeah. Churches break up and relationships crash and burn over the simplest of things. The simplest of things. When love is not covering the multitude of sins, when love is absent, anything can ruin your relationship. You don't believe it? Think about the things you have gotten upset about in your marriage, at your job, in your church over the years. Some of the things that have gotten you all fired up. When you really think about some of those things, they're not sin issues. They're preference issues. They're cultural issues. They're differences of opinion issues. Are they important? Sure they are. You know, we don't want to minimize the reality of those things. They are important. They do matter. But do they matter more than your relationships? No. Absolutely not. Christ died for you to be in right relationship with one another, not for you to get your way. There's a reality that needs to be recognized there. Christ didn't die for you to get your way. But He didn't die so you could be in right relationship with other people. What do you think tops the priority list here? There's covers a multitude of sin. It covers a multitude of disagreements. Because if I know that you love me and I love you and we're both working for each other's best interest, my preference can take a back seat to what we have to deal with. How often have we allowed sin to be punished within our congregation rather than to use that as an opportunity to seek redemption and restoration? Think about that for a second. The goal of us dealing with sin within the church is for redemption and restoration, not punishment. It's not my job to deal out punishment. It's not your job to punish someone for their sins. God's already got that under control. He doesn't need your help. Our job is to wrestle with those people in the midst of their struggle to help them be restored into a right relationship. How often have we withheld forgiveness from other people in our church because they hurt us? And rather than put their need for forgiveness to the forefront, we hold on to what we want as the priority of the relationship. Those matters reveal a lack of love within us. An intense love that's properly maintained will cover over those sins. This love lays a foundation in hearts and lives so that when sin must be confronted, it is confronted with a desire to restore. That when matters of personal preference run up against each other, they become secondary to the strengthening and maintaining of our relationships because of the love we have for one another. This love puts the need of others ahead of my own. Does that mean we can all be right? No. Decisions have to be made. Consequences have to be dealt with as a result of some of the decisions we make. It's not trying to be mean, not trying to be disrespectful, not trying to be... The fact is, you can't just stand around going, well, these are two perfectly valid opinions and we just need to stand here and stare at them. Love allows us to make decisions together and go forward in right relationship with one another. Oftentimes our relationships crash and burn because we see things as win or lose. If I don't get my way, I lost. That's just insane. There's lots of things I don't get my way on. It doesn't mean I lose. Most of the time, even when I don't get my way, I win because we move forward with each other. Whether it's in my home, or here in our church, or in the midst of my family, the goal is to go forward in right relationship. Not to get my way. Not to have things my way. True love does not center on having things my way. I will love you as long as I get my way. No. I will love you and I will go with you whether I get my way or not. Whether I think we came up with the best solution or not. Whether you hurt me or not. Because I love you, love covers a multitude of sin. And as we love and display that love with generous hospitality and without complaining, we see a love that covers our sins. This is the love that Jesus speaks about for his disciples. Jesus says in John 11, 13, that all people will know we are his disciples because we love one another. Our right relationship with each other that is centered on a liberal love for each other serves as our greatest testimony of Christ and his work within us. People will know you're Christ disciple if you love one another. But the inverse of that is equally true. People will not know you are Christ disciple if you lack that love. It's not just individual. If collectively your church lacks that love, they will look at your church and say, not Christ disciples. We are called to love one another. What does your love testify to others? What do they see when they see you? If we're going to have a testimony that says we are Christ's disciple, then we must love liberally. Ought equals can. But ought is founded in a right relationship with Jesus Christ. You can't be in right relationship with others apart from being in right relationship with Christ. The Spirit is not going to enable you to change apart from you being adopted as part of God's family through the work of the Lord Jesus Christ in your life. You can't love and live as Christ's disciple until you are first and foremost Christ's disciple through the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. So maybe today Christ is speaking to your heart about trusting Him. Maybe you know you want to be in right relationship with Christ. You want to be in right relationship with His church. And it starts by trusting Him. So this morning, if Christ is speaking to your heart, I want to invite you to respond during this time of invitation. As Christ is working with you, and as you express your desire to trust Him, we'll respond in an appropriate fashion. But this morning, if Christ is calling you, you are invited to respond. For some of you, Christ may be calling you to repent. Maybe you have been guilty of lacking that love. Maybe you have been guilty of carrying that complaining spirit, that critical spirit around. Maybe you realize this morning Christ is calling you to repent and change, to trust Him for the grace necessary to be what He's called you to be, to maintain an intense love relationship with each other. And if He's calling you to that time of repentance, I would invite you to respond this morning also. For others of you, maybe Christ is calling you to make this right here the local body of believers for you to be in right relationship with. Maybe He's calling you to come and present yourself for membership. Maybe you need to be baptized. Maybe you need to transfer your letter from another evangelical church. Or maybe you need to transfer by statement of faith. But Christ is calling you to make this your home. And if that's you, then this morning I would invite you to respond as well. And we'll respond in whatever way is appropriate as Christ is leading. But today, if Christ is calling you, this is your opportunity to respond. Now, is there anything magical about walking the aisle? Let me address that. No. It's just an aisle. It's carpet without chairs between you and me. But it is symbolic. So you ask me, what's the symbol? Here's the symbol. The symbol is getting a physical demonstration of your faith. Saying, Christ is calling me, and I am physically responding to what Christ is calling me to do. And that's what walking the aisle is. It's just a physical example of the faith you are expressing. And this morning, if Christ is calling to you to express your faith, this is your time to respond. In just a moment, I'm going to lead us in a word of prayer. At the end of that prayer, I'll be standing on the floor. And Wayne will come to lead us in our invitation hymn. And as he begins to sing that song, all you need to do is step into any one of these aisles and meet him right there. And as you respond today, Christ called upon your life. We will respond to you as your family, as those God has called to build relationship with you, to strengthen, to encourage, to protect, to love, to celebrate with, and to mourn with. But this morning, if Christ is calling, this is your time to respond. If you will, I just invite you to just close your eyes, bow your heads as we go to the Lord in prayer.